an author. He has written two notable novels, Cheney, The Untold Story of America's Most Powerful and Controversial Vice President, and Connection, How Al-Qaeda's Collaboration with Saddam Hussein Has Endangered America. You know, Mr. Hayes, you could work on the brevity of those titles, but otherwise I don't have any complaints. But Cheney is a study of how Dick Cheney fundamentally changed and altered the office of the vice president, and Connection is a very in-depth analysis of the relationship between bin Laden and Saddam Hussein following 9/11. These are both very extraordinary, fascinating reads. I can also say that Mr. Hayes has had his works published in a number of different news outlets, including the New York Post, the National Review. He graduated with a degree in journalism from Columbia and has served as the director of the Institute for Political Journalism at Georgetown. So he has an extensive journalism career, an extensive career in writing, and without further ado, please join me in introducing Mr. Stephen Hayes.
Good afternoon. How are y'all? That's pretty weak. It's pretty weak. I'm not going to make you do it again. It's great to be here. Thanks, JR, for that introduction. This is an honor. I've looked at the roster of speakers that you all have coming to join you over these several days, and what an incredible group. And I think it's a testament to the kind of work that Young America's Foundation has done over these past 35 years in bringing conservative speakers to engage with students and recent students and others. And it's just an honor to be here. The best part about being immediately preceded by Professor Robbie George and not long ago preceded by Jonah Goldberg is it'll keep me from trying to be someone I'm not. I won't try to be very intellectual because you've just heard from Robbie George. And I won't try to be funny because you heard from Jonah. And I would just try and fail. I'm guessing that Jonah probably told some Anthony Weiner jokes, am I right?
Yes.
They're among our favorites. As JR mentioned, I do work for Fox News. The show that I'm on most often is a 6 p.m. Eastern show called Special Report with Brett Baer, where I'm on the panel. And it's a great panel, and everywhere I go, I get questions about it. So I thought I'd start by anticipating and answering maybe some of the questions that you all might have, or those of you who have seen the show. So the first answer is yes, Charles Krauthammer is in fact that brilliant. Charles is great. Yeah, he's worth the applause. Charles is great, and what I find most important about Charles is that, I mean, you all can see how smart he is, but he's a very down-to-earth, easygoing, normal person for somebody who's a genius. And I can tell you that if I were as smart as Charles Krauthammer, I would be insufferable. So I think it speaks well of Charles that he's so down-to-earth. The second answer to the question that you all may have is yes. In fact, the arguments do continue into the commercial breaks. We argue through the commercial breaks, we argue into the makeup room, we argue downstairs to our cars. Sometimes I'm getting on the phone with Kirsten Powers on the drive home. How can you think that? And the third answer is, no, I've never actually punched Juan Williams. We've been close a couple times. We have very fiery exchanges, but I actually enjoy Juan. And he's, for me, proof that you can have civil disagreements with people from the other side and benefit by hashing them out without actually getting into physical altercations. Let me start with a story that I first heard from my big boss at Fox, Roger Ailes. Have any of you heard his story about the guy in the hot air balloon who got lost? No? Good. So Roger tells this story. He heard this story about a guy in a hot air balloon who was lost, and so this fellow lowered his altitude. He looked out and spotted a man down below and descended a bit more and then called out to him. Excuse me, can you help me? I promised a friend I'd meet him an hour ago and I don't know where I am. The man on the ground consulted his GPS and replied, you're in a hot air balloon approximately 30 feet above ground elevation at 2,346 feet precisely above sea level. You're 31 degrees, 14 minutes north latitude, 100 degrees, 49 minutes west longitude. The guy in the balloon, as you might expect, looks the guy on the ground rather quizzically and says, huh, you must be a conservative. The guy on the ground looks back up and says, I am. How did you know that? And the guy up in the balloon says, well, everything you've told me is technically correct, but I have no idea what to make of your information. The fact is, I'm still lost, and frankly, you really haven't been much help so far. The guy on the ground took a moment and considered this and yelled up, you must be a liberal. And the guy in the balloon says, well, I am. How did you know this? And the fellow on the ground looks up and shouts, well, you don't know where you're going or where you've been. You've risen to where you are on hot air. You made a promise that you have no idea how to keep. You expect me to solve your problem. And the fact is, you're in the same place you were before we met, and now somehow it's my fault. That's one of my favorite Roger Ailes stories. I'm still amazed that Roger Ailes actually hired me at Fox. I had been at CNN for a little while, and before that sort of broke into television back like 10 years ago, doing a show called The McLaughlin Group. Now, it was huge back then. It's not quite as popular now. How many of you watch The McLaughlin Group? Wow, it's really not as popular anymore. So it's run by Father John McLaughlin, who's this sort of loud-spoken, very tough questioner, and it's just a panel format. And back in the old days, my boss, Fred Barnes, was on the show, and Pat Buchanan was on the show. Eleanor Clift was on the show. It was a great old show, and I had come to the Weekly Standard. I got a job at the Weekly Standard, and then I got my first big break to do a TV show, and it was a call from the producer of the McLaughlin Group. And the producer called and said, hey, can you come in and sit on our panel? And I was, of course, ecstatic. This is what Fred Barnes had done. Fred's been a role model. So, sure, happy to be part of your panel. Where do you need me? And she says, you need to be at the studio at 1 o'clock. And this was on a Friday. She had called at about 11 o'clock. And when she said you need to be at the studio at 1 o'clock, it occurred to me that I probably wasn't their first choice. I was probably filling in for somebody, especially because her first question to me happened to be, are you wearing a suit? So I knew that they needed somebody who could appear on TV. So I go to hang up the phone. I scramble to get over to the studio. And as I'm driving to the studio, it occurs to me that I didn't ask what the topics were. It was really a moron mistake, sort of rookie mistake. So I call her back in something of a panic. And I said, OK, I need to know what topics we're going to be discussing before I can commit to coming on the show. And she says, oh, you'll be fine. It's going to be Iraq and taxes and cloning and something else. Iraq and taxes I'm okay on. Cloning, not great. So I decide I'm going to suck it up and go do the show anyway, take the chance. I get to the show. It's like, for a kid like me from Wauwatosa, Wisconsin, it's a dream. You know, I'm sitting there across from Eleanor Clift. Pat Buchanan was on the panel, John McLaughlin. And the show starts, and I'm nervous as heck. I'm like sweating like crazy. They keep having to give me like paper towels to mop my forehead in between commercial breaks. So the first panel's on Iraq. I do fine. I mean, it's nothing brilliant, but I didn't look like an idiot. The second panel's on taxes. I sort of survived that. And the third panel is on cloning. And the way that John McLaughlin starts his segments, he comes right back from commercial break, and there's an abrupt turn of topic. And what he always does is he'll say, issue one, or issue two. In this case, it was issue three. And this will be a terrible impression of him, but since you guys haven't seen him that much, it probably won't matter. So he starts the new segment and says, issue three. And he looks down the table right at me and starts his question. What does the organ transplant lobby think of Senator Mary Landrieu? I ask you, Stephen Hayes. I have no idea. I never knew there was an organ transplant lobby. No idea what they thought of Senator Mary Landrieu. So you have this moment. You're on TV. You're being filmed. And I stop and pause, and I kind of look across the table for help. I look over at Pat Buchanan and figure, he's, you know, we agree on some stuff. He might be an ally, might bail me out. I look over, and he just kind of sits back. And then I look at Eleanor Clift, who I don't agree with on anything, and she sits back and is thrilled at my predicament, kind of shakes her head like, don't look for help from me. And the whole time, I don't know if any of you have seen the Saturday Night Live skit about the McLaughlin group. It's this like imitation of John McLaughlin where he keeps, every time he mentions Eleanor Clift, he says, "Eleanor, you smell-anor!" And I'm literally sitting at the table looking at her, and that's going through my head. "Eleanor, you smell-anor!" So I have nothing to say. Nobody's going to bail me out, it becomes clear. So I start my answer. I look over Father McLaughlin. I say, "Well, this is really going to be a huge issue here in Washington over the next few weeks. You have people on both sides of the issue who feel passionately about their views. The organ transplant lobby, for instance. Senator Mary Landrieu. So I would look for a heated debate here in Washington, D.C. over the next few weeks." And that was it. Like, that's all I said. And everybody's looking at me like, "You are the biggest moron ever." And I think still to this day, it goes down as the most vapid commentary in the history of Washington commentary, which is really saying something, as you know. But I was in such a panic at that moment that I had real doubts about my ability to survive in journalism. You go through these kind of crisis of confidence. Can I make it? I mean, these people are all so smart. I'm an idiot. I don't know anything. Couldn't even answer the organ transplant lobby question. So I started to pay more attention to bylines, more attention to journalism, and more attention to headlines in newspapers and things. And I wondered, can I keep up with all of these brilliant journalists that toil away bringing our fellow countrymen the stuff that is so crucial to the very survival of our nation? I wrote down these headlines. And I soon understood why our country's in such trouble, because it became clear almost immediately that our low-information voters are getting their information from low-information journalists. These are actual headlines that appeared in newspapers around the country. None of this is made up. The first one, "Federal agents raid gun shop, find weapons." Subhead was, "Store owner previously arrested." The next one, "One-armed man applauds the kindness of strangers." "Tight end returns after colon surgery." Sorry, I asked my mom if I could tell that, and she said it was okay. So, there was a story in the Los Angeles Times involving Councilwoman Laura Chick, who was unhappy at what she saw as gender-based insensitivity among her colleagues. The Times headline over that story, "Chick accuses some of her male colleagues of sexism." Another one, "Students to cook and serve grandparents." No punctuation. So it reads like, "Students to cook and serve grandparents." "Homicide victims rarely talk to police." Wow. "Hispanics ace Spanish test." "Statistics show that teen pregnancy drops off significantly after 25. Who says that? And the last one, the scariest one for me in this situation, is "Man executed after long speech." Get it? Like, he didn't give a long speech and then was executed. He was like on death row. And anyway, so don't kill me after this speech. Let me get to the heart of my argument right away. We are in the midst of a great national ideological struggle. The country is divided along ideological and partisan lines to an extent we haven't seen in nearly a century. You often hear politicians describe the next election as, quote, "a struggle for the soul of America," or as "the one that will determine the course of this great nation." And they always do this, "this great nation." That's the usual, typical political hyperbole. But no longer. We are in the midst of a string of those kinds of elections, with lurches to the left in 2008, to the right in 2010, with fights about big issues that very well could determine what kind of relationship will be between the citizen and the state, and that may well decide what kind of a country we will be. The ideological battles didn't begin in 2008, of course, but they certainly intensified then. It's our Marco Rubio moment. President Obama was elected in the aftermath of the near collapse of the economy, and he was elected with a broad progressive agenda. But the conventional wisdom at the time was that President Obama would be, quote, "a pragmatist," And I heartily recommend Jonah Goldberg's Tyranny of Clichés for an exploration of that topic. The number of journalists who called President Obama a pragmatist as he ran for office, after he was elected, and to this day continue to insist that President Obama is a pragmatist is embarrassing. The conventional wisdom was wrong then, and it required ignoring what the president, or what Senator Obama himself had said during his campaign. He had basically made an argument that he was a deeply ideological man whose goal was to be a transformational president. He said this once explicitly in a January 2008 interview with a Nevada radio station. He was asked, what kind of president, who are your models, what kind of a president do you want to be? And he said, Ronald Reagan changed the trajectory of America in a way that Richard Nixon did not, and in a way that Bill Clinton did not. And that put us on a fundamentally different path because the country was ready for it. His argument, Obama's argument, was the country is ready to be put on a fundamentally different path. Now that comment made a lot of news at the time that he made it in January of 2008, in part because it came at the beginning of the Democratic primaries, where people were just about to go cast ballots in New Hampshire. And of course, running against Hillary Clinton, you can't take a shot against Bill Clinton. But he did. I think that that's an interesting window into the way that the president viewed his candidacy at the time and views his presidency to this day. Obama's objective, I think, was simple: to restore faith in government as a force for good and to restore power to government to effect broad change. The moment, back in 2008, was a good one for him. Americans plunged into a recession after the near collapse of the financial system were more open to government intervention than at any time in recent memory. But if Obama's ideology wasn't clear to those who covered his campaign, it should have been obvious with the first big push of his presidency, nearly $1 trillion in stimulus. A lot of it went to shovel-ready projects that the president later had to acknowledge weren't exactly shovel-ready. Basically, the federal government was throwing money at anyone, anywhere, and the value of the projects were less important than the fact the government was pushing out the money. This is sort of typical Keynesian economics. Among the many, many bad projects that were funded as a part of the stimulus, this one is my favorite. It's project number 1R01AA01658001A, malt liquor and marijuana. Factors in their concurrent versus separate use. $400,000 went to Dr. R. Lorraine Collins at SUNY University of Buffalo so that she could examine this crucial issue. It had been a four-year grant that she'd applied to for the first time, but it was changed to a two-year grant. She could do the same work in 2 years rather than four because that's what the stimulus guidelines required. This is from the official abstract that she submitted. We appreciate the opportunity to refocus this application to achieve a single important aim related to our understanding of young adults' use of male liquor, rather than malt liquor, male liquor, other alcoholic beverages, and marijuana, all of which confer high risks for experiencing negative consequences, including addiction. As we have noted, reviews of this grant application have noted numerous strengths, singular, have noted numerous strengths, which are summarized below. So what were those strengths? Quote, this research team has previously been successful in recruiting a large sample of regular malt liquor drinkers. And she wrote, this is true, and she wrote, the application is well written. Unclear whether the evaluators were drinking malt liquor when they judged that the application was well written. But there's no doubt that recruitment was strong. The authors were quoted in an academic journal called Psychology of Addictive Behavior, describing their innovative recruitment strategy to get people to join the study, subjects to join the study. Quote, we advertised in local newspapers and posted flyers on college campuses asking, do you drink 40s? That's their innovative recruitment strategy. So it was either that brilliant campaign or the fact that they were paying people to drink beer that resulted in the success of their recruitment efforts. But here's the kicker. The study was basically just an update of a study they'd conducted 2 years earlier. That project used regression analyses to find that, quote, those who concurrently use both alcohol and marijuana are more likely to report negative consequences of substance use compared with those who use alcohol only. Got that? $400,000 regression analyses to tell us that if you drink malt liquor and smoke pot, you'll be more messed up than if you just have a beer. That was the stimulus. And it didn't work. And it didn't work, not by my estimates. It didn't work. It wasn't the Heritage Foundation saying that it didn't work. It wasn't the Cato Institute saying that it didn't work. It didn't work by the White House's own projections. But the president wasn't done. Then came healthcare. Huge debate. You all remember the big debate, national discussion, all sorts of maneuvering and kickbacks and odd congressional maneuvers in order to pass Obamacare. And there came a time when it looked like it might not pass. And the president's advisors told him, go smaller. Let's do something more incremental and we'll add to this down the line. But the president, confirming again that he is in fact a deeply ideological man, said, no, we're not going to go small. We are going big and we're going to win. We're going to make it happen. So he did go big and Obamacare passed. And now we're seeing what the implementation looks like. A lot of the things that conservatives were saying back in the 2010 timeframe, the media is now reporting in a shocked way. I can't believe this isn't working. In 2010 came the repudiation. You had historical Republican gains in the 2010 elections. But President Obama didn't move to the center. He became more aggressively liberal after that repudiation. This made him, of course, the opposite of Bill Clinton. When Bill Clinton lost in 1994, he gave a State of the Union speech shortly thereafter in which he declared the end of the era of big government is over. President Obama used a State of the Union to make precisely the opposite argument. He doubled down, calling for more investment, and defended his activist first 2 years in government. In 2012, of course, we saw what was fundamentally a base campaign. The Obama campaign team decided very early that they were going to run a campaign aimed at getting out the left. This wasn't going to be a campaign that targeted primarily independents. They were going to, as they say, the favorite cliche of politicos, gin up the base. And they did. The Democratic National Convention in Charlotte was an unapologetic defense of activist government and broad cultural liberalism. And President Obama, to his credit, to the credit of his campaign team, he won. But Republicans, of course, retained the House of Representatives. And while President Obama chose to see his victory as a mandate for activist government, voters, despite the fact that he was reelected, didn't necessarily agree. One interesting question, I think it was the most interesting question in the exit polls that were taken on Election Day 2012, asked this question. Which is closer to your view? Government should do more to solve problems. Government is doing too many things better left to businesses and individuals. More government, 43%. Government's doing too much, 51%. And remember, that was asked of a sample that reelected President Obama. So it was already a skewed sample. And you even had that electorate saying, government's doing too much. Fast forward to the second inaugural. The president made clear that he had a bigger and more ambitious agenda than he even had in his first term. He didn't provide many details, but he said things like, preserving our individual freedoms ultimately requires collective action. The State of the Union, just a few weeks later, the president gave specifics to the outline he presented in his second inaugural address. And again, it was a robust clarion call to activist government, to proud liberalism. The New York Times, which doesn't, as you probably all know, write from a conservative point of view, had this to say in its analysis of the president's State of the Union the day after he gave the speech. quote, 32 years after President Ronald Reagan proclaimed that, quote, government is the problem, and 17 years after President Bill Clinton offered a surrender of sorts on that issue by stating that the era of big government is over, President Obama made a case Tuesday for closing out the politics of austerity. For closing out the politics of austerity. Now, this was not written ironically. This was on the front page of the New York Times. I didn't know we were in an era of austerity. We have $17 trillion in debt. That, it seems to me, would be breaking news. But interesting to me that the New York Times heard the president's speech the same way that I heard the speech, the same way that my friends at Cato heard the speech, the same way that Charles Krauthammer heard the speech. President Obama was calling for bigger government. But this is important. This is the turn. 6 months into his second term, the American public has seen a steady stream of news out of Washington that erodes trust in government, and erodes that trust at the very highest levels. That trust in government, of course, was key to the president building his agenda over the first 2 years, then the first 4 years of his term. What we've seen in the 6 months of his second term is an erosion of that broad trust. So let's look briefly at the four stories that have dominated the early part of the second storm, familiar to you all, familiar to anybody who reads a newspaper. Benghazi. A U.S. diplomatic outpost is attacked by Al-Qaeda-linked terrorists on the anniversary of 9/11. Four Americans are killed. The White House, which provided a minute-by-minute account of the president's activities and whereabouts on the night Osama bin Laden was killed, won't provide even a general account of the president's activities that night. This from the most transparent administration in history. Requests for help that came from Benghazi were either willfully denied or miscommunicated, but we know the end result. No help came. The talking points used to describe the incident were dramatically rewritten to reduce the emphasis on Al-Qaeda's participation and on terror, and they were rewritten after input from senior Obama administration officials. That fact contradicted directly claims from the White House and others, including Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, that the White House and State Department were not involved in any substantive revisions of the talking points. The supposedly exhaustive investigation into the attacks conducted by the State Department, known shorthand as the ARB, Administrative Review Board report, never interviewed Secretary Clinton, never interviewed the Secretary of State about an attack on our diplomatic compound in Benghazi that took the life of an ambassador. Other top officials whose story contradicted the preferred Obama narrative and who volunteered to talk to investigators were told, thanks, we're good. And those who did speak out, career government officials, not political appointees, not holdovers from the Bush administration, but career government officials who did speak out, say that they've faced retribution from top Clinton advisors for having done so. So that's story number one. Story number two, Justice Department investigations of journalists. Dramatic, unprecedented overreach by the Justice Department in its investigation of the Associated Press in seizure of its phone records. Targeting my colleague, Fox News reporter James Rosen, lead reporter at Fox back in the days when he was covering the White House's war on Fox, as it was known. The lead reporter for Fox covering that effort, James Rosen, his emails, his parents' phones, all of them scrutinized. Attorney General Eric Holder, on the potential prosecution of journalists, testified before Congress under oath, quote, that is not something that I ever have been involved in or that I would think is a wise policy. But Holder, of course, led the discussions at the Justice Department about a warrant that characterized James Rosen as a possible co-conspirator and worried that Rosen might even be a flight risk. The White House, I think despite the fact that what Holder had testified to was demonstrably false, backed him. Jay Carney said, I think based on what he said, he testified truthfully. Then there's the IRS, the systematic targeting of conservative groups. The story that was revealed when Lois Lerner, the head of the IRS tax exempt division, famously now planted a question at a conference, an American Bar Association conference. We now know that there have had to be major substantive revisions to the initial storyline offered by the administration when the story broke. It was not, of course, merely two low-level employees in Cincinnati. We now have proof of high-level DC involvement and direction. Asked to explain more than 150 trips to the White House, IRS Director Doug Shulman dismissed the question in congressional testimony by saying he might have gone for the Easter egg roll. The investigation's ongoing. There's a lot more to learn, but we know the results. We know the effects. Conservative groups testified that without the approval they were seeking from the IRS, that they have been, in effect, dormant, their word, dormant, since the 2010 midterm elections that spawned them, since the passage of Obamacare, since the stimulus. They've been dormant. So you wonder, you know, the questions before the 2012 campaign, journalists asked all the time, where are the Tea Party groups? Where are the Tea Party groups? Well, now we know where the Tea Party groups were. And then finally, the NSA. Into this poisonous environment, we get the NSA leaks. The president, who had opposed these programs as a candidate and campaigned on his opposition to them, now endorses them, sort of. Collection is up orders of magnitude under Patriot Act Section 215 since 2009, since the president was inaugurated. The top U.S. intelligence official was asked under oath, does the NSA collect any type of data at all on millions or hundreds of millions of Americans? And James Clapper, the head of the DNI, said, no, sir, not wittingly. Again, we know that statement, demonstrably false, and Clapper has since had to back away from it. Now, I don't regard all of these four controversies as the same thing. In Benghazi, you had government incompetence and highly misleading claims from top officials. The Justice Department investigations, unprecedented invasive probes of journalists. The IRS, again, we have a lot more to learn, but at least we know that it was a bureaucracy out of control that happened to target opponents of the party controlling the executive branch, which controls the IRS. The NSA is a little bit different. I would call it a controversy rather than a scandal, because I think these are generally defensible programs that have prevented attacks, but the disclosure of operational details and the subsequent misleading testimony about those details contributes to perceptions of government overreach. But taken together, I think there is no question whatsoever that they erode the trust in government that was so important to Barack Obama's hopes to, quote, put us on a fundamentally different path, like he said about Ronald Reagan. And he's still trying. Back in May, the president gave a speech at Ohio State. Some of you may have heard about it. Maybe some of you were there. He said this, unfortunately, you've grown up hearing voices that incessantly warn of government as nothing more than some separate sinister entity that's at the root of all of our problems. Some of these same voices are doing their best to just gum up the works. They'll warn that tyranny is always lurking just around the corner. You should reject these voices. Well, it's become a lot harder to reject these voices when they've been proven right again and again and again over the last 6 months. Since the president made those comments, his approval ratings have gone down across the board, but most importantly in the demographic that you all belong to. A CNN poll taken in late May found that President Obama's disapproval is up 9 points overall since the previous month. And his approval amongst his most enthusiastic supporters, young voters ages 18 to 29, plummeted by 17 points since May. A Fox News poll found that 68% say government is out of control and threatening civil liberties, including half of the Democrats in that poll. Just 26% of those polled disagreed with that claim. The latest White House tactic, of course, is to dismiss these as phony scandals and to try to get the White House press corps to move on. But White House advisors and the president himself didn't always think that these were phony scandals. Their previous defenses on each one of these scandals were some variation or another on the one that David Axelrod offered one morning on Morning Joe when he was asked to explain the abuses at the IRS. Axelrod said this is an actual quote. part of being president is there's so much beneath you that you can't know because the government is so vast. Think about that. The man who came to Washington promising to remake America by expanding the power of a beneficent government has been reduced to explaining away abuses of that power with the grudging acknowledgement that government is just too damn big. So in the end, I think it likely that President Obama, like Ronald Reagan, may end up being a transformative president. Because like Ronald Reagan, but for very, very different reasons, President Obama will bring about a renewed interest in limited government. This, in fact, is a struggle for the soul of America. And I think, strongly believe, that we are on the verge of a strong and sustained conservative revival. Thank you again for having me. Appreciate it. We have time for a few questions. Yes, sir.
Hey, okay. Hi, my name is Peter Jensen. I attend Patrick Henry College in Percival, Virginia. And my question to you is regarding the Obama administration's covering up of the recent scandals over the last 6 months. Do you feel at any point that there are going to be possibly more scandals that just make it impossible for them to be able to defend themselves the entire time and it just blows up in their face? Or do you think that they actually are going to be able to weather the storm that they're facing and hold out for another 4 years?
Yeah, it's a very good question. Let me start by saying that I was wrong in my earlier assessment of this. In my earlier guess, I thought that I'd spent a lot of time covering the Benghazi story dating back to October. And, you know, when you're familiar with the facts, when you get down in the weeds about what actually happened in Benghazi and you compare, you know, what the White House was saying with what basically everybody else was saying, you begin to think that that's going to be a big problem for the White House. And for a while, it was. There was finally, I think, in connection with coverage, news coverage of some of the congressional testimony that we saw from these very compelling career government officials, the White House felt the heat about it. And then there came a point where the White House provided these talking points, all sorts of emails about these talking points. And what those emails demonstrated clearly, and I made reference to this earlier, is that the White House spokesman Jay Carney, Hillary Clinton, others, had not been honest about the White House's involvement in the revision of those talking points. And I thought that reporters in the White House press corps, having basically been misled for months and months and months, and written stories for months and months and months based on assurances that they'd gotten from White House and State Department officials, I thought that for no other reason, just on sort of personal anger, they would have started to cover this a little bit more, if not for curiosity. I mean, I'd be curious if I knew that they were not telling the truth this whole time. But at the very least, I would be personally offended if people had misled me deliberately. And that's what had happened. But it didn't, as I anticipated. I thought it would probably lead to more coverage of it. And it didn't. And so some of these things are going away. And I think if you look at what the White House is doing right now by calling these phony scandals and then launching, you know, the president's new tour on economic policy, and, you know, they leaked something today calling for a new grand bargain, which was neither really grand nor a bargain. But journalists are willing to be led that way. So the White House says these are phony scandals, we're done with them, we've dealt with them, even though they haven't actually answered many of the questions that led to the scandals in the first place. The White House press corps seems, at least at this point, to be ready to move on. They're kind of done with it. They don't want to investigate it the way they have. So the shorter answer to your question is no. I don't think that they're likely to have to ever give full answers to a lot of these things. Doesn't mean that we'll quit covering them. I mean, I think they're important stories. Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. My name is John Wood, and I am a high school student in Upland, California. My question has to do with the Middle East. Benghazi, obviously you just said that you covered it a lot. And in light of even more recent developments in the Middle East as a whole, more protests in Benghazi, Egypt, the overthrowing of the new ruler there, my question is how is the Obama administration, do you think that they're dealing with it properly? I know that there's been a lot of criticism of how the Bush administration dealt with Iraq and Afghanistan in his administration. Do you think that they're justified not to go after Obama for the way he's dealing with the Middle East as a whole?
No, I mean, I think you can't not have a strategy. And that's basically what we have from this White House. I come from a school of thought that believes that the United States, being the world superpower, should try to shape outcomes in the world, should try to shape the world to do what's in U.S. national interest. You're not always going to be able to determine the outcome, but it doesn't mean that you shouldn't try to shape them. Now, that doesn't mean that we should be the world's policemen, that we should be involved everywhere and always. But I think if you look at some of the places that the administration has failed to act, I would point to Syria as the prime example. What might have been avoided with a limited short-term intervention early in the process, we are now seeing is a disaster. I mean, it's a humanitarian disaster with more than 100,000 people having been slaughtered. It is now basically a civil war. I don't think there are really good guys in Syria, or the good guys that there are in Syria are so few and far between and so overwhelmed by the Islamist Al-Qaeda allied fighters challenging the regime that I think it's increasingly difficult to make the case that we should be helping to arm them. Even if I thought that was maybe a good idea or the least bad idea 18 months ago. I think there's a problem with that. And the way that this administration, I mean, it's been very clear from the beginning that President Obama wanted to have a domestic policy focused presidency. And if you go back and you look at his second inaugural, it's clear that he wants to spend his second term focused on domestic policy. I mean, he said during the campaign, we need to, what did he say, nation building at home, not abroad. That's a paraphrase. And I think that's the way that he's governing. I think, unfortunately for him, the world isn't going to cooperate. The United States doesn't get to make choices like that. And when we do, I think we pay the price for it.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Christian Anzel. I go to the University at Buffalo. And once again, I apologize for my professors who have shown a great dereliction towards their conduct. Not unusual at our university. What do you think is the biggest issue going into the midterm elections?
I think it's going to be a combination of sort of broad erosion of government stories. You could call them scandal stories. I think, you know, they won't be as white hot. These scandals that I discussed won't be as white hot a year from now, but they're there. I think they will sort of inform all of the arguments that are traded back and forth as we head into the 2014 elections. And then I would think, and I will say I would hope, that Obamacare is a key part of that discussion. I think the overwhelming majority of conservatives on Capitol Hill want to challenge Obamacare in one way or another. Mike Lee, you all heard from Mike Lee today, has one way. I wrote a piece about his approach to it for the Weekly Standard this past week. There are others who are saying that you could attach some kind of a one-year suspension of certain parts of Obamacare to raising the debt ceiling, and that might be a way to go. I don't think there are many conservatives and or Republicans who just don't want to deal with the issue. There are some, and you see this, some conservatives are writing about this now, and you see some people talking about it. But I think that would be a huge mistake, because we are going to be witnessing, especially if nothing is suspended come this fall, we are going to be witnessing the slow motion collapse of Obamacare. It is going to be, I mean, a train wreck, I think, might be a pretty description of it by the time we're on the other side of it. It's not going to be good. And I think Republicans will talk about it, conservatives will talk about it, and they should.
Afternoon, Mr. Hayes. My name is Mateo Moran. I go to Hillsdale College. And on the topic of scandals, my question to you is, which do you think of these two scandals is the biggest one that's going to affect us in the United States, either the precedent that's being set by the Obama administration, what it's doing with the NSA, the IRS, and whatnot, or Ryan Braun doing steroids?
Are you asking that because I'm a Milwaukee Brewers fan?
Yes.
Yeah, thanks. Appreciate that. Look, I mean, Ryan Braun lied. There's nobody's defending him, and nobody should be defending him. I mean, it was interesting to see his statement. It was just a give-up statement. You know, it's like, I got busted. I'm not going to even pretend that I didn't get busted. There it is. So, yeah, I think it's far more important what the Obama administration does than Ryan Braun. Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Take a 5-minute break.